Hello, my name is Nico Tilly. I teach and do research at the Faculty of Architecture and Landscape Architecture. And I'm a research fellow, Urban Ecology from BirdLife Netherlands. And today we will visit Bob Ursem. Bob Ursem is the director of the Botanic Garden at TU Delft. And he will guide us throughout the garden and show us many interesting details. So yeah, I invite you to come along and have a look what Bob has to tell us.
Welcome in the Botanic Garden of Delft University of Technology. This garden was established in 1917, and the interest of the university at that time was of course given by the activities that we have all over overseas in all kinds of colony areas. Before, at that time, we were just gaining materials from all kinds of colonies, but later on we had a change of thinking, and that brought the whole things back to the Netherlands, and they had an idea to use plants for industry. And of course we had no system and no place to expose that, and that's why the king of that time decided to station that in Delft. And this was the first start of what we call the Culture Garden of Delft. It's a culture garden. It's not a botanic garden at that time, as such mentioned, because it was purely designed as a technology botanical garden. That was new to the botanical garden world at that time. Technology botanical garden will mean that we only nurse useful plants, plants being used or applied for mankind or for industry. But also extracts of plants, like a grass, it's called vetiver grass, and the extract of that plant is an important source to manufacture all kinds of soaps and soap industries, like the firm Boldoat. It's probably not known to everyone, but it is the one which has discovered the aftershave. The aftershave as a product was here also started in this botanic garden. But not only the interest of plants of products directly, but also the interest of studies what's behind it and what is happening with plants, what you can make out of it. It's the first plastic factory, and also the establishment of TNO, that's the Dutch Institute of Independent Research and on Natural Products at that time. Dus that was also established here from this botanical garden. Still today, we have a lot of new technologies still applied also, but then in a very different way. We work together with civil engineering, but also with architecture, but also with industrial design, and all those factory faculties had their own problems and their own activities where plants can play a role in as a part of it. A good example of the applied way of plants is also to be seen at the entrance of this botanical garden. You see many plants which are also useful, huh? Like this little shrub here. This is also a perfume plant for soap industry, but we do have also lavender, which is very known for all kinds of soap products. But not only that, also the shape of the garden is also of interest. Because not only plants, but the combination of plants and the shape of the setting of the plants really can also provide a very important way of using plants for industry. You have a lot of traffic noise at the back, you can still hear from the traffic. And if you see this slope a little bit upwards behind me, that is also making the movement of the air upwards, and also the sound goes upwards. So that means that the hidden area behind it is much more silent. So the combination of plants as a filter for sound reduction is also the shape of the garden, with making hills, is another part of it. And we're steady going to see stepwise what its effect is. Behind me is a big pond with fountains in it. And the sound of water, after you enter the botanical garden, you first have been lifted the sound upwards. And now you hear overwhelming the sound of water behind me. So the idea is that the sound of the traffic is banned away from the outside. So this is the second step. And the third step we're going to encounter behind me now is the step we're going to see here right after. After we've passed the water with the fountains, you have this noise of water. And then we go a little bit down. You can see that the garden is hidden a little bit lower than the entrance part. So the sound is really killed in the trees behind me. And in the lower place, you don't hear so much of the traffic anymore. And now you hear the sound of birds. So you have a mindset change from the entrance to this point, that you have first the city with the noise, and now you have to hear to listen now to the birds and to the environment of the botanical garden. So the use of plants and the landscaping of the plants in the setting really makes a big difference. And that's what you can encounter here and you can experience here. The garden is not only connected to the traffic on the outside, but underneath the traffic there are a lot of eco-ducts we made here. Like an example, this one is in the botanic gardens, the entrance of it. And the other side is also a park. So all the green parts in Delft can be connected. And this is also a good idea for other places in the campus, because this is the only place we do have it now. But in the future we should connect all the green parts of the campus together. And these ecoducts for green parts is also important, because we have frogs, we do have all kinds of hedgehogs, small clinic of animals, there's like mouse and all kind of other little creatures still moving around here in this area, and like salamanders and all these small species, and they can still connect to all the places where we do have ponds and we do have the systems of what's ecological interest of interest, as well as we do have here. Next to all kind of interesting connections to the outside, the botanical garden has also a huge, rich history. And of course, trees like this one, a poplar tree, but the Canadian poplar tree, is of course of use for making the wooden shoes, but also all kinds of light timber materials. But we have a specimen right here, which is exactly from the original date of the botanic garden. So that means that this plant is planted in 1917. And we live now in 2020. So that means that this plant is 103 years old. That's incredible for a poplar tree. Normally a poplar tree will grow, and then inner side is a lot of sugar made. And sugar is not connected and can be transported easily in the trunk. The trunk starts to decay a bit, because the sugar is converted into ethanol, in alcohol. And alcohol kills the plant, and that's why you have this typical perfume of what you call a sherry perfume out of it. And then we know the tree is dying. But this specimen is still wonderfully alive after 103 years. Still existing in this botanic garden. That is the oldest poplar tree we know in the Netherlands so far, recorded. Besides all the technology applied, or the applied plants, a botanic garden has also another function. And that is actually a function of keeping the biodiversity, and also especially rare and vulnerable plants. Vulnerable plants means plants that almost get extinct on the earth. And one of the good examples is the recently discovered this plant. This is in 2004 been established in this botanical garden, but in 1994 this was discovered in the Blue Mountains of Australia. This is the wallaby pine. This plant is almost extinct in the earth, because we really only know this plant from records of fossil records so far. And then a ranger in Australia discovered this on a very small slope. Only six specimens were still surviving. The seeds were sampled, and the seeds were being taken and been distributed all over the botanical gardens of the world, included Delft. So we have this specimen also since 2004 in our collection. And we do have contact with all the botanical gardens in the world, 640 in total. We do have seed exchanges then, but also exchange of vulnerable materials. If a plant is especially rare here, or unknown to other botanical gardens, and other part of the garden can help and support to keep this plant alive, maybe for a purpose in the future, we can exchange that with other gardens. So the network of botanic gardens play a crucial role in plant diversity and plant species conservation. directly after the arboretum, which is connected to the entrance of the botanical garden, we have a steady stepwise opening up of the garden. The garden has a very different shapes of landscaping and landscaping design. So we're now in a section where we see that the arboretum is being stopped so far, and behind me are opening areas with grass fields. So it's an entirely different experience and an entirely different environment. In this opened up area where we are right now, we have a lot of birch trees. Birch trees are interesting because first they have a white bark, and white bark means that they have a lot of air in it. That's the color white. If there's anything colored white, then it is air. But this one is specially because this can peel off the bark. And this bark is useful because we know that these plants live also in moors and all kinds of extreme wet areas. There's a lot of decay in those areas, so the tree trunk itself will be easily be digested by the all kind of creatures. But the park's bark stays always a long time, so it can be preserved in wet areas. And we thought it of interest because we really were had a keen idea to see what we can do with all kinds of wood preservers. And many wood preservers are extremely toxic and of course forbidden to use. So we use alternatives, and one of the possible alternatives can be found in the birch tree, because the bark has some components which are interesting, because if we can extract those components and we can do it on wood, we have a beautiful wood preserver for the future on biological basis. This is another aspect we work on right now. One part of the botanic garden is a very formal garden. That means square shapes and all the settings are symmetrical. And this is just a place like that. But in the center of it, there is what we call an artisanai garden. Means a medical doctor garden of the past, which is refers to the history of Delft and especially to the history of aspects which are of keen interest to the public. In example, we do have plants behind it here of the balsaming of Willem of Orange. Willem of Orange was of course killed in 1584, and after that it needed to be preserved, his body. And you need plants to preserve a body of a person. And so therefore all the species are gathered here which been used to make the balsaming and all the activities of it. So we can still see today what they have used at that time. But not only that, we do have also a very old traditional way of the knowledge of what we called the apothecers, or what you called the druggists of that time. Also the plants we use, and that is the Dodoneus Kruidboek plants. And these are also in this botanical garden. So it is actually an historical setting. In the middle of this formal garden, very symmetrical, is a huge tree behind me. And it is called the Major Sequoia Glyptostroboides, or actually the Chinese mammoth tree, or the Chinese giant tree. And the interesting part is that this was also a fossil record until 1949, it was discovered in the area of Wuhan. And Wuhan is the central part of China. And these plants were still there near a temple. And the specimens collected there were only 500 seeds, not more available. This was distributed from the Arnold Arboretum all over the world. And a few seeds also arrived in Delft. We nursed these plants, and we do have two specimens of the old part of that time still existing here in this botanical garden. Later on, discovered on other places similar plants, but not exactly like the old temple specimens. So we know that this specimen is specially from the old data, from the very first plant collection. And the interesting part of it is its phenomena, its feature, because the trunk itself on the basal part is like a big thickening, a lower basal part, like a caudex formation. And this is very typical, distinct for the shape of this tree of the original plants. All the later discovered plants have a straight trunk and have not the thickening parts of it, with the big winding parts like what you call plank root systems. One of the plants of interest, also in technology way, you can't find right away in just one strike. And a good example is this Bird of Paradise flower from South Africa. It's also the logo of the botanical garden. And the interesting part is this blue part. This blue part can move around. As you can see, the wings are popping out. And a bird normally pollinates this plant, but gets landed on this spot. And then his feet get stuck like a clam. And then you need to get first to the nectar, but it couldn't get away very easily. So the trigger of this plant is to keep the bird longer in the flower to make the pollination more possible. But in technology way, if you can move this around, you can see that it's moving and backwards and forwards. And the thing of that is that technically applied, because all kinds of screening systems of buildings are made exactly in the same way. So this plant gives the information how to do, how to deal with technology application, once again, of a plant. One of the parts of the botanic garden is are little rock gardens. Those are especially created for dry environments and of course high alpine species. So this is one example here for a number of labels, but also a number of small plants. And all these plants have a typical growing area because they need to have dry and very exposed positions. That's why you see an open situation here of these dry plants. Such is a totally different environment. The garden is positioned in the surrounding of many, many waters. We do have the Schie Canal, we do have the Schie River in the neighborhood, and the Schie River is connected to the North Sea. So a lot of salinity, a lot of water problems really are encountering this area and also come in the botanic garden. In 1917, they saw this already as a big problem. In order to solve it, you can have water from very pure resources. And one of the resources is nearby, is the Akkerdijkse wetlands. But also the other area, in the Witpolder, there's a similar wetland area. It's now an agricultural system. And then at that time, they thought already, we need to get the water from this spot. And still today, we have this water directly, as it's been also in the same way, in the traditional way in 1917. The water is run by a tube to the botanic garden, 2.5 kilometers away, being pumped up, being directed to the botanic garden, filling all the water containers of the glass houses, but also all the containers for the water system of the whole garden. And what's left over is a little current of all the moving water, of steady water, most pure as you can think of. It's not drinkable, I do it to Pfizer because there are always microorganisms in it, but the water for the plant is extremely pure. And another thing is that if the water system is being brought to the center of the botanic garden, the water can only flush out on all the outsides. So that means that the whole water, the whole draining system, what we have here, is from inside to the outside. So there's no connection from the outside to the inside. This is very important because also for the total area of the TU Delft, we do have water problems as well. So if we create a system where we pump the water from far away into the system and from the system inside out, we bring the water in, we can purify and create a tremendous amount of beautiful environments. An ecological way, the best approach. Because we have beautiful water in the botanic garden, we can create a tremendous amount of different environments. And sometimes the water is so extremely pure, but not pure enough for plants. Plants have sometimes another demand, and even have more pure. That means what we call oligotroph environment, which means nothing, almost nothing in it. And one of the examples to do that is this big filter system behind me. And this filter system circulates the whole water in this pond again and again in a very steady, slowly way. And you see here a lot of algae growing, green stuff here. And you can see it's still rich enough to grow these algae. But stepwise, you go from a rich environment to a more, here, a more pure environment, a more actually an environment with less nutrients. And then you all of a sudden you see occurring all these plants, like Hotonia, and like here the water strawberry, as an example. But we can also make a step further after a filter, and then we end up in this place. And here you see these little plants, very strange plants. It's not algae, this is a plant, it's called Utricularia. It's a plant which only can grow in environments where are no nutritions or very limited nutritions. And these plants have little capsules to capture all kinds of small creatures and to eat it. It's actually a flesh-eating plant. So it can thrive in this environment, very, very low on nutrients. But if you get a step further on land, you do have also nutrient poor environments as well. And this is a bog of all kinds of sphagnum species, and inside a very vulnerable species of this bog environment, like this lavender heather, but also small plants in here, which is all kinds of pinguiculas, which is called the vetblad in the Netherlands, but it's also pinguicula in the Netherlands in English, and this is also a flesh-eating plant, but also plants of environments which have been typical for a bog environment, like these plants, and over there some others like the how do you call it? Cranberry. And here you see Hypericum species in between, but all kinds of small species. And the thing is that this environment can only thrive on rainwater, the purest of there is. But of course, the rainwater here is not pure, because we do have a lot of pollutions. This with the pollutions, you need to purify the water all over and over again. So we have this purification system to nourish this bog system, and the bog will grow itself. It started 10 centimeters below the wooden part, and now it's way over, and it's really lifting the water out of it and growing together with it. And this is a very typical environment, and we call it high bog, or high peat areas. And this is peat, of course, is created from these species. So we create from a very rich environment to extreme pure, nutrient poor environments. So we can create all kinds of possibilities. And in landscaping, this is also important. If you can create several environments, it's good for the biodiversity and good for the total all over view, because then you have an ecological system that you can bring from the outside to the inner side of the city. We do have these systems equal in the Akkadijkse swamp areas, and it will be wonderful also to create these kind of environments and to connect those worlds together. And that's possible. Technology is not a problem, as you can see here. On the top of this filter system, we do have an interesting environment. It is a very low topsoil layer, but this is all chalk material. So we have here a chalk meadow created with all typical species in the chalk area. Because a lot of orchids are growing here in the summertime, it's full of orchids, but now it's a little bit, looks a little bit dry, but it is still a very interesting environment with typical dry plants. In the middle you have small plants, and all over there, even on the other side, we do have species like thymus and all kind of those plants of typical dry environments. Like the environment on the top of the filter system, we have here an ecosystem. This is also a very dry chalk area. And this is actually a chalk grass area with the grass lily and many kinds of orchids. Here we have an orchid which is called the wasp orchid. This is the common orchid we have here, and here we have DUF2, and do we have also different species like Dianthus and all kind of other species. So a lot of plants typical, which are extremely rare in the Netherlands, are so surviving in each environment. And so we create all kind of boxes with each own environment, own ecological system. And that we can do also in our campus area. Create many species so we can really enjoy the different kind of environments we do have in the Netherlands with the rare species, and also maintain biodiversity. The plant I mentioned before was the plant which provided us the aftershave. This was already originally in the beginning of the Botanic Garden of the interest. And one of the plants is this, vetiver grass. Vetiver grass is a very typical grass with extremely long roots. And the root system is really being shown in the future in this cylinder, because then we can see what the effect is. And the interesting part is not only the grass itself, the leaves. The leaves are the extraction of the leaves is giving the aftershave. The leaves can also be used for woven materials, to make basket making and all kind of mat making. But the root system is interesting because the roots are going straight down and they form on several layers, they form side roots. So you create a sort of a matrix inside the soil. A matrix stabilizes the soil, especially on very steep slopes, but also for actually benches of rivers and canals to prevent erosion. And this is exactly the application we've done in the tropics. This plant normally occurs in Africa and also way up in all tropical Asia. So people from Africa and Asia will recognize this species and they can see how you can apply it. In the past they use a lot of timber, a lot of construction materials, and now you can easily use and plant these plants in boxes right here on this frame, and they will grow the system inside the soil itself and stabilize the canal benches. Plant applications, as I mentioned also once, was actually many ways. And in civil engineering, an interesting plant is this one, Bugueria. It's a mangrove, but the mangrove of the freshwater. And the interesting part is in freshwater areas, we do have erosion problems with rivers as well. And in order to stabilize the benches of rivers and tide regions, we can this in tide in delta areas, we can stabilize in many places the land very quickly. And also gain land again. Because these plants form climatophores or aerial roots. They go straight down and as it is growing on stilts. And in between they can also capture a lot of kind of salt, a lot of sand and silt materials in between. So you can even capture the soil and gain so land stepwise because you use these plants. In mangrove systems, in salt areas, they do form also stilt roots on the outside. And as soon as the stilt root system capture all the sand and the silt material, right after the situation became a little bit more stabilized, you get different species with pinnate erect roots upwards. And those forms a sort of a frame to capture soil material, so you can grow stepwise to the outer side and create a lot of land from nothing in the beginning, gain sand and silt material from then up to a huge forest. And the interesting part is that all the wave impact can be diminished to zero, and you only need a little dike, a small clay dike in the hinterland to have to block the water with the high tide. That's the only thing, but no wave impact. So a very sustainable coastal defense. We are here in a small place of the botanical garden, which is a little bit hidden. And this is a very typical environment. You see a lot of bamboo behind me and very steep slopes of this small canal. This is one of the outlet areas where we have water running out to the outer area. But the water is extremely pure. And there's no nutrients in it, or limited nutrients. So all kind of small fishes, very tiny fishes, are living in this environment. This is also the breeding place of kingfisher right in the botanic garden. It's very unique to have a vulnerable species, a rare species of bird in the Netherlands, and to see this in the botanical garden as a breeding place. This is what I mean, creating environments. Ecological environments, and especially ecological engineering in architecture and landscape design, is of extreme importance to create all kinds of habitats. Habitats to preserve nature, but also bring nature closer to people, and also serve people. We know all, if we will have a house, if we live near a place of a park, of a green area, the house is more vulnerable, more worth in money. It's also a very pleasant environment to live in. And this is actually what we have to focus in the future. We have, in architecture, it's extremely important to create ecological systems near the houses. And I think it's crucial for the future to have these things arranged, not only to bring in nature from far away inside the city, but also create in the city environments so the cities itself forms corridors of ecological systems from way out and connect other ecological systems. And that's why ecological engineering is so important in all kinds of studies and also to use it as practical information of new planning, new development, and I think it should be the first one to think of. And then the next one will be the houses to fill in. And everyone knows if that is done in a perfect way, then we have an inclusive nature, environmental created, beautiful environment to live in. City life is getting more and more. Nowadays, 70% of the population is living in cities. In the future, 90% of the population is living in cities. So this becomes more and more important.